Hi, I'm Adam. This is the Machine Tech video blog, and today I'd like to talk to you a little bit about grinding cutting tools for the lathe. Offhand grinding of cutting tools is a traditional machine shop skill which may seem out of place in today's highly automated manufacturing landscape. However, learning how to grind cutting tools and then using those tools to machine parts on a lathe is an excellent way to build intuition about cutting tool geometries and their effects on tool performance and part quality. Also, the versatility of custom tool grinding is advantageous even in the modern industrial shop. You can modify or resharpen existing tools, or dial in that perfect tool geometry for a tricky cutting operation, or you can create a special purpose tool if an off-the-shelf option is unavailable, or if ordering from a vendor would result in unacceptable time delay or expense. Ultimately, learning how to grind cutting tools is a rite of passage for students and apprentices, and it's a core job skill for journey-level machinists. So, you might as well learn it now. Tool grinding is a rich and complex topic, and it would be impossible to cover all aspects here. We've decided to concentrate on demonstrating some procedures for grinding a few of the most common cutting tools. Even with this narrow focus, we'll have to split this video into multiple bite-sized chunks. This video, part one, will contain some very basic background information on cutting tool geometries and cutting tool materials. Parts 2, 3, 4, and 5 will contain demonstrations of procedures for grinding a general-purpose right-hand cutting tool, a left-hand cutting tool, or facing tool, a chamfering tool, and a threading tool. We'll also throw in some tips and tricks along the way to help ensure your success. Here's a machining operation already in progress. When a cutting tool engages a workpiece rotating on the spindle of a lathe, it wedges into the work material and causes the material to deform by shearing action. The material then fractures, separates from the workpiece, and flows across the top of the tool in the form of a chip. This happens continuously if the cutting tool is fed by the machine at a steady rate. The shape generated in the workpiece during the cutting operation is determined by the path along which the cutting tool moves, its tool path, and the shape of the cutting tool, its geometry. Let's look at the geometry of this tool a little closer. It's constructed from three pairs of angles: two cutting angles, two relief angles, and two rake angles. The side cutting angle forms the cutting edge, the working part of the tool which engages the material. It's sometimes referred to as the lead angle, which is not entirely correct because the lead angle can actually be adjusted by changing the orientation of the tool relative to the workpiece on the machine. The point on the tip of the tool where the cutting edge ends is called the tool nose. Except for the side cutting angle, all of the critical angles on the cutting tool slope away from the tool nose in order to expose it to the workpiece. The position of the tool nose relative to the workpiece during the cutting operation is what actually determines the shape and size of the final machined surface. Also, notice that the tool nose is radiused rather than pointed, which improves the part's surface finish and increases the durability of the tool. The end cutting angle provides clearance behind the tool nose, and the side relief angle and end relief angle provide clearance underneath the tool nose in order to minimize rubbing. Finally, the side rake angle and the back rake angle on the top of the tool are the angles at which the workpiece material is sheared, and consequently they determine the resistance experienced by the tool during the cutting operation. The rake angles have the largest impact on the performance of the cutting tool and are optimized for the workpiece material.
These basic elements of tool geometry, cutting angles which define the cutting edge,
Relief angles, which reduce rubbing, and rake angles, which optimize the tool's performance, are shared in common by all cutting tools, but they come in many different styles or configurations, each one with a geometry designed for a particular type of cutting operation. They fall broadly into two categories, point cutting tools and form cutting tools.
Point cutting tools, predominantly single point cutting tools like the tool we used as an example, are designed to generate a part surface by continuously feeding a cutting edge along the path of the desired profile. If the direction of feeding motion is parallel to the axis of the workpiece, the generated surface will be cylindrical. This process is called turning. If the direction of feeding motion is perpendicular to the axis of the workpiece, the generated surface will be flat. This process is called facing. If the two principal directions are combined into a simultaneous feeding motion, the generated surface will be tapered. Common single-point cutting tools are the facing tool for generating flat surfaces, the turning tool for generating external diameters, and the boring tool for turning internal diameters. Single-point cutting tools are versatile because they can be used to generate virtually any desired profile, so long as the tool can be guided along the correct path. Form cutting tools are designed with a cutting edge of the exact reverse shape as the desired profile of a part surface. When plunged or moved along a prescribed path, the cutting edge will impart its shape to the workpiece. Common form cutting tools are the chamfer tool for generating 45-degree angles on edges, the radius tool for generating radii in edges and corners, the grooving tool for generating square-sided recesses, and the threading tool for generating screw threads. Form cutting tools are efficient because they can be used to generate even very complex profiles with a single motion. But designing and grinding a form cutting tool with an intricately shaped custom cutting edge can be both time consuming and expensive. Regardless of the tool geometry, there are two main forces in a cutting operation. The first, and by far the largest, is tangential to the workpiece and directed down onto the top of the tool. The second is normal to the cutting edge and directed opposite the feed motion. These forces can be enormous, even when a cutting tool's geometry is perfectly optimized. Therefore, the material out of which the cutting tool is made must satisfy three criteria. 1. It must be hard enough to resist wear and abrasion. Look at what happens when we try to use a tool made out of aluminum to cut steel. Yikes, too soft. 2. It must be tough enough to absorb the energy transferred to the cutting edge, including large sudden impacts or shock loads without fracturing. For example, this glass should be able to cut the steel, but nope, the tip broke right off. Too brittle. And 3, it must retain the aforementioned mechanical properties at the elevated temperatures generated by friction at the cutting edge.
In the early days of precision metalworking, the cutting tool material of choice was plain steel with a high percentage of carbon. This material can be heated and quenched to make it very hard and still pretty tough, so that satisfies two of the criteria. But the friction generated during the cutting operation quickly causes the cutting edge to overheat and lose its hardness. Machinists of old had to keep their cutting speed slow, and they made frequent trips to the grinder to retouch their tools. The 20th century saw many new manufacturing technologies, including new cutting tool materials called high-speed steels. These highly alloyed tool steels contain the usual iron and carbon, as well as chromium, vanadium, tungsten, molybdenum, cobalt. The hardness achieved by high-speed steels is similar to plain carbon steel, but they retain their hardness up to around 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. This property is called hot hardness, or red hardness, because steel glows a dull red color at this elevated temperature. Compared with their carbon steel counterparts, tools made out of this material can be successfully operated at much higher cutting speeds, hence the name high-speed steel. Now, although high-speed steels have been replaced in many applications by newer and even harder materials like tungsten carbide, they still find their place in the modern machine shop because of their relatively low cost, good machinability, and toughness. High-speed steels come in various grades. The grades most commonly used for grinding cutting tools are M2, M42, and T15. M2 is a general purpose grade of high speed steel with molybdenum as the primary alloying element. It's often selected because it's relatively inexpensive, but its excellent toughness also makes it ideal for interrupted cutting conditions like ripping through weld beads. With the addition of cobalt as an alloying element, M42 exhibits enhanced hot hardness for even higher cutting speeds. And T15 adds a significant percentage of tungsten to the mix, which means it's very hard and very wear resistant, but also more brittle and extremely expensive and very, very difficult to grind. High-speed steel is commercially available in standard blanks of different sizes and different basic shapes, square, rectangular, blade-like, and so on. We'll be using half-inch square M2 high-speed steel to grind our cutting tools in the next part of this video. Well, there's your basic introduction to cutting tool geometries and cutting tool materials. And that's it for part one of our five-part series on tool grinding. Stay tuned for part two to see me grind this general-purpose right-hand cutting tool on this grinder. As always, I hope you learned something.